We are currently in a room full of people from several different kinds of backgrounds. However, a common entity that ties us all together is water. Water, this seemingly simple and abundant substance, is actually one of the most precious commodities on the face of the earth, yet less than 1% is suitable for drinking. Thus, advanced technologies for water purification are essential to meet the needs for clean drinking water. And this is where my world of polymer science comes into play. Polymers are long molecular chains that are comprised of repeating units of smaller molecules. And the polymer of interest in my research is known as polyether sulfone, or PESU, whose repeat unit structure I have displayed. Now you can imagine this repeat unit as a small bead that when multiplied several times forms this long polymer chain. I'm particularly interested in this polymer in that it is easily fabricated to form filtration membranes that have the ability to filter and purify water for safe human consumption. These filtration membranes are thick, porous material that allow for purified water to flow through the pores while preventing the flow of harmful entities such as bacteria, viruses, and algae. These membranes are comprised of these long PESU chains that demonstrate excellent stability in water. However, the surfaces of these materials are very difficult to control, and this is for two reasons. The first reason is that polymer chains tend to move and arrange themselves differently at their surface when they come into contact with a new environment, such as water or air. And second, the undesirables that are prevented from flowing through the membrane begin to accumulate on that polymer surface, and this eventually becomes detrimental to the filtration performance. Now, in advanced countries, this is easily overcome by simply replacing the polymer membrane after a period of time. However, in developing countries where clean water is already very difficult to produce, they do not have the financial stability necessary to easily replace these filters. And this problem motivated me to take that step back from the big picture and to look at these materials on a much smaller scale. In my research, I am trying to determine the fundamental laws of thermodynamics and polymer physics that dictate the arrangement of these chains at their surfaces. And in this manner, I'm endeavoring to elucidate how different environmental parameters can alter the surface properties of these polymer membranes. And ultimately, I hope to improve PESU materials to enable longer product lifetimes and better suit the demands for clean drinking water in developing countries. Thank you.
When you think about the effects of steroid hormones, you probably envision a muscle-bound bodybuilder. But steroids can cause a broad range of physiological processes beyond just building muscle. Two of these include energy mobilization, which is the release of stored glucose, and hydromineral balance, which is the regulation of things like blood pressure or blood salt concentration. Now, usually these two separate processes are controlled by two separate steroid hormones. But in sharks, skates, and rays, or what we call the elasmobranch fishes, we have a single novel steroid called 1-alpha-B that performs both of these functions. Now, this presents us with an interesting question. Does this mean that every time 1-alpha-B is secreted, that these organisms experience both increases in their blood glucose and increases in their blood pressure or blood salt concentration? Well, this is exactly the question that my proposed research will examine. Specifically, I'll investigate the mechanisms that regulate the actions of 1-alpha-B and identify factors that determine when it's acting in energy mobilization and when it's acting in hydromineral balance. Now, the way that steroids work is that they travel through the cell membrane, they bind to DNA, and there they act to turn genes on or off. What I plan to do is take the tissues of the Atlantic stingray, expose them to various doses of 1-alpha-B, and then identify the genes that are affected as a result of these treatments. This analysis of the genetic actions of 1-alpha-B will help us to understand how and when this steroid performs its different functions. But you might be wondering why it's important to understand this. Well, energy mobilization and hydromineral balance are involved in stress, and if you're a marine organism, they're involved in your movement between water bodies with different salt concentrations or salinities. Now, certainly these are things that elasmobranchs experience every day, but the frequency with which they encounter these challenges is increasing due to human activity. Sharks and rays are often caught as bycatch, and as such, they experience the stress that's associated with capture and handling. Coastal elasmobranch species can encounter rapid human-induced changes in environmental salinity that are brought about by actions like spillway management during flood events. Now, you probably already know that elasmobranchs are important to the marine ecosystem because they help to maintain balance within those food webs. But what you might not realize is that nearly a quarter of those organisms are listed as endangered species. So this research is important because it will lend insight into how elasmobranchs cope with the physiological challenges that are brought about by human activity. Thank you.
When I chose to go to graduate school, I felt proud of the large investment I was making in my future career. However, I neglected to seriously consider how this 5 to 7 year commitment might influence my ability to meet my other life goals, such as becoming a wife and mother. This got me wondering how many other people feel torn between pursuing their work goals and their family goals. Americans in particular can stand to gain a lot from understanding the role of work in our lives as our society shifts into a dual earner population. In other words, most Americans will be expected to hold a paying job at some point in their lives. So although many of us have hopes and dreams of building a family for ourselves, it is likely that we will be faced with the complex task of making a career decision that can alter the time we spend with our family. For the past 50 years or so, vocational psychologists and career counselors have been wondering why choosing a career is so hard for some people, yet effortless for others. In this way, I became passionate about the relationship between the importance of certain life roles and how hard it is to make a career decision. By assessing the survey results of students here at USM, I found that students who were invested in the role of a husband or wife often had a hard time making a career decision. On the other hand, students who indicated that being a parent was important to them often had significantly less difficulty making a career decision. Now, what's interesting is that students' value of their work role did not seem to make a difference one way or another as far as how hard it was for them to choose a career. All of this indicates that it is specifically one's investment in their family that can make choosing a career easier or more difficult. These results are extremely important. Paralyzing levels of stress are often experienced by those who are unhappy with their career choice or for those who feel stuck and unable to choose a career path. Now, even more serious and more concerning are the mental health implications of the unemployed population, which include depression, substance abuse, as well as even suicide. These are the challenges that most clients face when they come into career counseling. And this is the reason why career decision-making difficulty needs to be taken seriously. I can honestly say at this point, I do not regret choosing a career path that requires a doctoral degree. However, I can say that I am anxiously counting the days until I can spend more time with my husband than my dissertation. Thank you.